So elections can go sour in lots of ways. I mean, somebody might try to manipulate the elections. If the only results are on the computer, someone could manipulate the computer somehow. So for that reason, I like to have elections based on paper ballots. Paper ones are less open to manipulation. Yeah, a computer, particularly one that might be connected to the internet, is terribly vulnerable. Somebody's counted the paper ballots and announced the result, but you might still be a bit skeptical. You should be skeptical, right? I mean, this is important, and well, the loser will be skeptical anyway, for sure. And so you want to process a post-election audit, is what we call it, for really convincing the loser that the announced result is the right result. And so there's lots of techniques for that. I can describe one of them that I like to you. But post-election audit takes the pile of cast paper ballots and does a statistical sample to see if the outcome is consistent. Yeah, if you have an election with 1 million voters, recounting all of the ballots by hand, which is what a recount is about, that's a lot of work. But a statistical recount, you might have to look just 100 ballots or something like that and say, yep, that's consistent, and you can stop there. So they can be very efficient because of the statistics involved, even for very, very large states or jurisdictions, just looking at a few ballots. We've seen that already in the real world with polling and things like that. Statistical samples give you confidence of the outcome. So you take a random sample, you do some checking, you look at the random sample by hand, not by machine, because you're not trusting the machines here. So you look at the random sample by hand, you see, well, who won the sample. But you may also do some other computations, as I'll describe, for checking how likely it is that that sample is consistent with an outcome that was announced. Maybe that the sample is too small, that you really can't tell who won in the overall election with much confidence from the sample. And so the overall audit has a higher level loop. Higher level processes, draw a sample, check that sample. Maybe the answer is draw more, make the sample larger. So you might go from 100 ballots to 200 ballots, then you check a 200 ballot sample, and then maybe you're done. So there's many different ways of doing this, and part of it depends on the kind of election you're having. So let's imagine we have a first past the post or a plurality election. So whoever gets the most votes wins, and there the math is pretty simple. And we'd like to check whether a pile of cast ballots is really consistent with the announced outcome. So we want to do an audit. How could we do that? So let me illustrate that with this pile here. Pile of cast ballots for Alice or Bob. That's the whole election, right? So we've got this is a small county or something. It's only got 16 ballots. So you can imagine it's not 16, but 1,600 or 16 million. But it's a big pile of paper, and we don't really want to look at it all in order to see who won. But it's been announced that Alice won. And we want to check that is that correct? You can flip through it, you can sort of look and say, yeah, there's some Alice's, there's some Bob's, and maybe she won by 11 to 5 or 10 to 6 or something like that. There's some count. We don't need to verify the count as much as we want to verify the winner. Really, if the count's off a little bit, maybe that doesn't matter so much. It's interesting, but it's the real question is who won the election? And we have been told that Alice won, and we'd like to check that. We don't really trust the person who counted, or we're the loser. And we're Bob. We're told that Bob lost, so we're Bob. And Bob is distrustful of the process. He wants to have his people participate with the election officials in an audit and to confirm that, yeah, he did lose the election. Or maybe he didn't. Okay, how do we do an audit? There's a couple of ways of doing it. I'm going to describe one that's called a Bayesian audit that was developed by a student of mine, Emily Shen, and myself. But like most audits, it starts with a sample. So we could take a sample and draw a few samples. Let's take here's one. I'm just drawing at random. Here's one. We choose some initial size of the sample. So there's our sample. That looks pretty much like it's an Alice win, but that's just a sample, and who knows whether that's data to really tell. And it depends a bit on how close the election is. If it's a very close election, a small sample like this may not be enough. All right, so what do? So we've got the sample. We can see who won the sample. The truth, of course, is who won in the whole pile, not who won in just the sample. The sample could be misleading. Sample could be too small, the sample might have too much of the loser's ballots. So we have to have some process of figuring out what the whole collection of ballots might have looked like. You sort of like to do some unsampling. That's sort of a funny notion, but you'd like to take the sample and expand it out in some way to look like, without having to look at the ballots anymore. We only want to look at these ballots, but just only looking at these ballots, we'd like to unsample, which is to come up with a prototype or an estimate of what the whole set of ballots might have looked like. And we can do that many times. So let's try that once. So here's a sample of four. What kind of set of, we had, what, 16 ballots altogether. What set of 16 ballots might there have been that could have produced such a sample? And so in a probabilistic sense, we're drawing from the posterior. We have a well-defined distribution on the set of all possible things. But it's easy to describe. There's this beautiful technique due to Polya called Polya's Urn, which allows you to grow a sample to a larger thing that it might have come from. And so we do that. We pick one of these at random. Let's say I happen to pick this one. Bob, pick one out and put two back in. So I've got a sample of size 4. I'm going to grow it up by 1 to a sample of size 5. I'm going to make a copy of whatever I drew. So here's Bob. I put another Bob, and I'll write it in green so you know it's been copied. So now I've got a sample of size 5. This isn't really a sample from what came here. It's sort of my Polya's Urn grown sample. Now it's 3-2. Well, whatever. But we had 16 originally, so we want to repeat this process. So we draw another one at random. Well, maybe I draw an Alice. So I'll put another Alice. I pick one out and put it back together with a copy of it. So now I've got 6 ballots. That's cool. So now I've grown it a bit. So now it's 4-2. And I can continue this process. I pick one at random. Maybe I pick one that I copied already. I copy that and put it in. So you can see how this would go. Let's do this. So I've now got a 4-3. So I want to grow up to 16. So I pick one at random. Got an Alice. Make a copy of Alice. So at the end of the urn process, we've got 16 again. And we can pretend like that's the full cast set of cast ballots. And we can see who won. And so maybe Alice won. So we can put on our chart and say Alice won that simulation. These are really simulations, so Alice won one. But there was uncertainty there. We could have drawn cards in a different order and maybe gotten a different result. So we can imagine doing the whole process again, starting with our 4 and growing it out to 16. So we do that and we see who won and may get a different set of ballots. Maybe Bob won that one, okay? So there's, if it's fairly evenly balanced at the beginning, you know, Bob's gonna win some, Alice is gonna win some. And that's the key here is you do a lot of simulations of this sort.
On the one sample.
On the one sample, maybe Alice wins lots of them, Bob wins some of them, but maybe it's fairly close, you know? So we'd like to have 95% confidence, so we maybe want Alice to win 95% of the runs here. If she doesn't win 95%, we say, this sample's not big enough. So we start over, we make the sample bigger. Maybe we draw some more, we go back, we enlarge the sample by drawing some more. So new sample is twice the size. We said the original one wasn't big enough. So now instead of growing from 4 ballots out to 16, we're growing from 8 out to 16. And we count, see who wins. And maybe this time Alice wins them all. You know, maybe the sample's bigger now. It's really pretty clear mathematically from the sample that Alice is the winner. And so maybe she's winning them. Maybe Bob wins one or two or something, but you know, it's really overwhelmingly clear that no matter how this gets extended out by Polya's Urn, you've got Alice winning. And so that's how the audit might proceed. You could say, well, we grow the sample, and this still could be a pretty small sample by comparison with the total set of cast votes. We might have a sample of size 100, and that's pretty small, and the computer can do all this stuff fast. So there's very little examination of the paper ballots. I don't really care too much what technique you use. I really do think that if we should have paper ballots, and we should be doing post-election audits just to confirm that the announced outcome is really consistent with the paper ballots. Those are two very important properties we should have of all of the elections everywhere in the U.S. or the planet. Get a receipt when you vote, and the receipt is not the plain text as to how you voted, but an encryption of how you voted. So it's something that you can't sell down at the bar because it's not something that's interpretable by somebody else.
So what is it, like a number or a barcode?
It's a number or a barcode or something like that, and it represents how you voted.